to be here. And I have to tell you, I'm frankly a little bit nervous. I talk in front of kids all the time in small groups of adults, but this is going to be fun. We'll see what happens, right? That's serendipity. It's going to be good. So, like Amy said, I own the Craftsman Apprentice. Has anyone ever been to our shop? Yay! Oh, how nice. So, we're a little craft studio over in City Park West, and I'll share a little bit more about that later. I've lived in Denver since I was 18 years old, which is half my life, and I was an elementary school art teacher for a long time, and we'll get to how this all leads to where we are today. But we're here to talk about serendipity, and that's that warm, fuzzy feeling where the stars align and things come together in an unexpected way. So when I was first asked to talk on this subject, I thought, oh, that's so silly. Life is just a series of random events done. The kind of teenage existentialist in me is like, whatever, the world's absurd, things just happen. but then I started researching and asking questions, because I'm a teacher and that's just what we do. And I came to understand that serendipity is much the sum of your experiences as it is chance. So in the next little bit, I'll describe ways in which we can recognize and cultivate those kind of happy accidents. And you guys all kind of imagined one when you walked in. I'll tell you a bit about me and how I came from being a pretty privileged kid on the North Shore of Chicago to being a craft workshop owner and a gentrifier in Denver. But first, let's talk about tying the knot. How many of you guys grabbed the activity when we first walked in? Okay, so let's talk about it. Who got the first one that just told you to tie it up? Zara, how'd it go?
I had a happy accident.
It was tied in the front, but not the back.
All right. Did you know what a figure eight knot was?
No.
All right. How many other people got this one? How'd it go? Very nice. So you used, we're going to call it schema. So that's what you already knew to help you do something new, right? Who got this and had no clue what to do? Did you try? He's just got a string. He's like, someone help me. All right, so then who got this one that just had written instructions? How'd that go? It was okay? Did you know anything about tying knots before? Okay, so she's like, whatever. I got this down. I'll save your life. Anyone with no background with this one? It went terribly wrong. How did you feel? Embarrassed. Maybe a little awkward. It's a little uncomfortable. All right. Who got this one? This one's like the golden one, right? How'd it go? All right, who else got this one? This one is the one with the print and it has a visual aid. How'd it go? Were you able to do it? Pretty successful, right? So you had, I scaffolded this one. So if any teachers in the room? All right, cool. So you know what I'm talking about. Scaffolding is creating an environment for success. So taking what people already know, creating environments and spaces where people can be successful pretty much no matter what. You're kind of taking the guesswork out of a learning experience. Who got this one? Ask someone to teach you how. Mom, how'd it go? You didn't ask it, Brenda. Just like, help me. Anyone else get a chance to ask someone? How'd it go? Do you want to tell me? Did you ask someone? Yeah. Right, sometimes that's the case. You're like, I got it this one time, and then I didn't. Did anybody feel uncomfortable asking someone to help them? Outgoing? It was okay? So, we're going to talk a lot more about... can't see my stuff. Oh, there's... Okay. Sorry, guys. We're going to talk a lot more about what that activity means as we get further into the talk, and about creating environments that are conducive to to happy accidents and positive experiences, which is what we're all going for, right? Connection. But first, we're going to talk about love. Who loves love?
I do.
When I was getting ready for this talk, I put it out on Facebook. I was like, tell me about your serendipitous moments. And most were kind of like how their grandparents met or how they met their sweetie. And these are my grandparents. They've been married for 72 years. My mom is right here, so I'm just going to refer to her. And I'm going to show you a quick video of them sharing how they met. A good friend of ours, Sam Pike. Do you guys know Sam Pike? He did forum stories. Anyone? He's fantastic, if you don't know him. He came and shot some video of my grandparents.
Told him since he only had one student, could I get him a Saturday night off and go out for him? That's awesome. The stuff I like to do. He said, fine, that was all right with him. So I went to this dance, and here were these two girls that I used to play ball down in Wimbledon in Boulder. They're sitting there with another girl that I hadn't noticed before. And it turned out it was my wife.
No way.
She was a full sister of these two that I knew real well. But in all that 5 years that I had known them, they had never mentioned her. But there was no reason to.
So how old were you then when?
I'm 17.
Okay, so you're 17. You needed a date to the dance.
Very few people date that go to the dance. They usually met at the dance.
Gotcha.
So I convinced. I thought, well, I know these two girls she's sitting with, maybe she'll dance with me. So I went over and asked her, and that's because she's related to them. She says, I'm their sister. And I thought, I've been the biggest liar in the country. I've known those girls for all that time. She's trying to tell me she's their sister. Well, it turned out she wasn't lying.
The other side of the story.
Yeah, let's hear your
story. Well, I was a sickly baby, and I lived with my grandparents. My grandmother took care of me. And during the Depression, people did things, they had what they had to do, and my mom, you know, had to live to it in Boulder. So I was 16, my cousin came from California, and they were going to go dancing.
Yeah.
And I'd never been, except the local.
Oh, you'd never been dancing before?
Well, I'd been dancing.
Yeah,
we had a town hall, they had a family Saturday night dance there.
Okay.
But I got to go to Boulder, and that's when I met him.
Yeah, they used to have Boulder, but right across to the city, I was trying to use south of Boulder, right across.
My grandpa will tell you all the details. one part of this story is that my grandmother was wearing a red sweater, and my grandpa always tells that part of the story. And it's like legend in our family, you know, the red sweater, meeting the sisters, not knowing her, and if they had never met when they were 17, then that's, hold on, I have my calculations here. Four kids, 11 grandkids, 16 great grandkids would have never been born. So good thing for like red sweaters and dances and all that good stuff, right? What happened? My grandparents built a life of being kind, thoughtful, and generous. And when they look back on their 90 plus years on Earth, the moments where the things you thought were going to happen went another way, and this novel, new, surprising opportunity, connection, experience took them on a whole new path. And it's beautiful to know people this long, and we're this old, because they'll tell you things happen, and there's this kind of you never know kind of thing that happens in life. But it also takes a little planning, so we'll talk about that. In my own life, if I had never met my husband John, wave at him. Who would I say, you know what would be awesome on a daily basis? So I'll tell you kind of our analogous love story, which is not quite as charming because I was wearing a Ted Nugent t-shirt, but I've known my husband John since I was 15 years old, but we really connected when I was 20. I went to my cousin's house to go see Hot Water Music at the Ogden Theater, and I walked into the room and John stood up and said, "I'm John." I said, "I know who you are." But I fell in love with him, and we've been together for 16 years. We're business partners, creative partners, and we have two kids together. So there was our red sweater moment. Thanks, Ted Nugent. So I want you guys to take a moment to think of a defining moment in your childhood. For the sake of this talk, we're going to focus on the positive ones. I know that there's plenty of negative experiences that are totally out of your control that have formed you as a person. We're going to just stick with the happy stuff because that's serendipity. So think about it for a moment. Your childhood creates a narrative for your life and sets you on a certain path. So I'm going to kind of share with you guys a little bit about my childhood. Part of that is because I work with children all the time, and I think often about how I'm creating memories and experiences for those kids, and hopefully serendipitous moments, aha, kind of spark moments for them. And so I'm going to tell you about some of mine, and then I'm going to make my mom cry. Oh, wait, there's me and John. What's our one? Okay, that's me. I had really terrible eyes when I was a kid. I had to wear glasses and an eye patch. I don't know how serendipitous that is, but my mom would say it made me smarter. So when I was 5 years old, my mom took me to high tea at the Drake Hotel in Chicago, which is super duper fancy, and there was a woman there playing the harp, and I became completely obsessed with the idea of playing the harp. And so my parents obliged and let me start playing the harp, and I played for 7 or 8 years, the whole of my childhood, and my poor brother would have to schlep my harp back and forth and back to lessons. And I was that kid that played the harp, but I didn't stay that kid. One thing that my mom also did was take us to the Art Institute in Chicago, and that museum, I think, changed me as a person. I discovered art, and you know, we saw Seurat and O'Keeffe and Calder and Rodin and all of that, and I remember reading George O'Keeffe's biography, and it said that she was an art teacher. She was an artist, you know, the whole of her existence, and I felt like, oh yeah, I could do that. Like, look at her. I could totally do that. And a couple weeks ago, I went to New Mexico for the first time. I took my kids to the O'Keeffe Museum and totally had a moment where I just like cried and started. It was like, it happened. And now my kids are there and they're so beautiful. So I had these, you know, experiences as a kid, and then so a little bit more background. My mom, my grandmother, my two aunts are all super crafty, industrious, lovely humans. And they would set up projects for us. They would just give us junk to play with. We would do all of these things all the time as kids. And we were just free to be and to make and create and like totally supported. And it was really lovely. And, you know, now that I'm a teacher, I know that that's just good teaching, right? To create a safe environment for kids to explore and to make messes and have accidents and to try again and to be creative and to expose them to new things. And that's just really good teaching. Oh, jeez, sorry. I'm gonna get it together. Okay, there's me again. Okay, so then we'll talk about choices. So serendipity, we want to think that there's like no control in that, but my philosophy around serendipity is that none of these things happen unless you have all of your schema, right? So you're not ready to have that moment unless you have the space to discover it. So that means if my mom had never taken me to the art museum, if, you know, my grandparents had never met, if I had not, you know, you go on this path, and then that leads you to exactly where you are, right? And exactly with all of the schema and understandings to have those experiences, right? You're not going to discover something new in science unless you're already a scientist, maybe. So, and same as being an artist in the art gym, I'm sure. You have to have some skill, knowledge, and structure in order to have those kind of beautiful serendipitous moments. So when I was 13, we moved to Boulder from Chicago. My mom let me and my brother decide where we wanted to live in Colorado with some help. But we had been to Boulder and we knew where the record stores were and we knew where the used bookstore was. And so we're like, yeah, take us to Boulder. And I was able to go to an alternative high school. My friend Zara over here, 20 years. Serendipitous, we would have never met. But in that experience, I learned more about learning. So we would have to do, we had to do service learning, and we ended up being a part of a project called Project Interact. And it was for technically at-risk youth, and all of a sudden I was an at-risk youth. Yeah, because that's me. Being dangerous, making poor choices. And we worked at CU in the fine arts department with other artists. I'm so sorry. That just keeps going on. And this is where I discovered the studio or the workshop, because I think it's one of the most serendipitous places on earth. And it helped for me as a teacher and an artist. When you work with other people in a space, that's when those moments occur. And say, what do you think about this? What are you doing over there? And when you're working, sometimes as an artist or a creative, I know a lot of you guys work at home alone, sometimes it's really hard to find innovation just within your own construct, right? But when you get people together and you have something to offer and I have something to offer, we can create spark. So within that program, working with kids and seeing what would happen when you made art and had an opportunity to work with other artists and learn from them, I knew that that's what I wanted to do. So I moved to Denver when I was 18 and went to art school and started making art, thinking that I would leave, but I never did, because I love it here. And when you're somewhere for 18 years, you end up knowing a lot of people, and you can have a lot of serendipitous moments because you do have connections with all sorts of people, and that's a beautiful thing. So, I'm gonna go back to being 12 and living in Chicago. So I grew up in kind of a well-to-do area of Chicago, and one time they wanted us to do some service learning. So they put us on a bus and drove us to the south side of Chicago, basically to play with poor kids at a Head Start program. And I remember being really rocked by that moment because I felt like they were using these kids as a way for us to all feel better about ourselves. And it felt disingenuous. And I just remember that sat with me as I moved into a career working with children. Has anyone heard this quote before? Education is radically about love. Fury wrote a book called The Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And it is one of those moments that affected me forever, is learning that the best learning environment is one that's built on love and respect and openness. And I'm sure that you would experience that too. You don't have serendipity without a sense of safety and a sense of security. This is a photo of my grandfather and my uncle. And I feel like this is like an archetypal image, right? This is love, confidence, all of that good stuff, all wrapped into one. So I went on this path. Once I was in college, I decided to become an art teacher, and I started working with a mentor teacher, and it turned out, which is a serendipitous moment, and she grew up in the same hometown as my husband. She was a little bit older, but she had the exact same art teacher, Mrs. Osterberry, who taught my husband how to be an artist and a creative thinker, and also taught Amy. And this woman has no idea. And I love that she probably doesn't know that she had this effect on people, right? It's the same thing as we talked about when you're a kid and those people impact you and you just don't know it. And I ended up getting my first job at a bilingual school in Edgewater. Here's some kids. Kids are great. So when you're a teacher, your job is to get kids to spark, right? And especially as an art teacher, that's like, I can teach you how to draw, that's cool. And you do need some skills. So we talked about that, right? Laying some foundation. But really my job as a teacher was to teach kids to think critically. And there's two parts to this. So I think she mentioned before, so I have a master's degree in cultural and linguistic diversity, and I worked with a lot of English language learners. And there is a theory, it's called the input hypothesis. And that theory says that the only learning that you can do as a person happens when you have all of the things you already know, plus one thing that's a little bit beyond what you know. So if you can imagine that you're stuck in a room, it's kind of like the cave analogy, you're stuck in a room listening to a German radio, but you don't have any input other than the talk on the radio, you're not ever gonna learn to speak German, right? You're never gonna get anywhere with that. But if you had some schema, some visual cue, some scaffolding, right? Something that would be put in place to help you get from the known to the unknown, because that's serendipity, right? Just kind of warm, fuzzy feeling to it. So as teachers, it's our job to create those environments. And as creatives, also our job, because that's how innovation occurs. So then there's this other thing called hierarchy of need. Do you guys know what that is? Okay. So Maslow says that no self-actualization, no innovation occurs unless there's this hierarchy of needs that's met. So that's like safety and security, shelter, food, water, love is on that hierarchy of needs. And then once you have those, and self-esteem. So a child, a person, you need to have those needs met before innovation, self-actualization, or any of those things occur. So one of my jobs as an art teacher was to create that space. And the coolest thing about being an art teacher, here's Frankie, he's an art teacher, is when kids come to your space and they feel happy and safe and loved, and then they do work. And they might not do work anywhere else, but they do work there because all of their needs are met, at least in that one space, and they feel free to make mistakes. And they feel free to fail and get up and try again, all of those things. So this is what's leading me to how we ended up at the show. Oh, wait, I have to tell you one more story. Can I tell you a story? This is one of the, like, scaffolding stories. We had some kids who were refugees from Tanzania, and it was about summer, and they were about to go to summer school, and the teachers were all excited, we're gonna take them swimming, this is gonna be so cool. And so they got a bunch of books from the library about swimming. So this one kiddo was like, hi, what's up, I'm gonna swim, and he read all these books about swimming. And then they went to the pool across the street from our school, and he, you know, whips off his clothes, he's got his swim trunks on, he runs to the top of the high dive, he jumps in and he sinks like a stone. And his favorite teacher sees him, she jumps in and just rips him out of the water. And he's like, oh, are you okay, are you okay? He's like, that was awesome. He's like, I'm doing it again. So he like runs away from her, does it again, falls in the water, and this time, she lets him flail a little bit. Because the first time he had no fear, right? Because he was so safely guarded that he had no idea that he was in danger. So there is something to be said for over-preparing and overly controlling your environment and thinking you know when you just don't, right? You're like, oh, I read a book about that. I saw it on TV. But unless you actually try it, unless you get in the water and have a little danger, you may not know how to swim. So moving forward into my life, I got pregnant with my first son 2 weeks after I started my master's degree. And that was great, serendipitous. It worked out just fine. So this is Milo. He's about to turn 10. And this is Wyatt. He's about to turn 7 tomorrow. And when Wyatt was a baby, I was staying home. I took a leave of absence from my teaching job. And I was about to turn 30, and I was feeling super antsy. I just didn't know what to do with myself. So we decided to turn this tiny sunroom into a studio. And I did a project where I made 100 paintings in 100 days. And I had always been working as an artist, but it was just kind of on the side. But this would give me structure, it would give me purpose outside. I love things, but I'm kind of crazy. I have a lot going on up here, so I needed more. But my kids worked with me. So what ended up coming out of this experience was that I bartered probably 75 of my paintings, and I had a lot of really beautiful moments with people where I said, what do you have to offer? This is what I have to offer. Let's make it happen. And I made friends, and I had cool experiences, and I got some massages, it was nice, free babysitting, it all worked out. But it gave me practice, and it also gave me time to watch my kids in a creative space, and notice that what I wanted was the same thing that my grandma gave my mom, and my mom gave me, which was a place to be messy, and a place to try things on. So this is my little made of my scuba outfit. He approved of it, sure. So a bit after the 100 days, I went back to work, and I was working as an art teacher and a content integration specialist. So we were putting things together for classrooms and kind of trying to create some more innovation in the learning environment. And to make a long story short, working in highly impacted, high poverty schools for any sort of longevity when you have small children is it's tough. And I had some serious burnout. I'm a kind of all-in sort of person and an all-heart kind of person, so I needed to do something else. And John and I have been having these conversations for a long time about what it meant to be parents to children and teaching and learning and all of those things. And we also own a stone masonry company, and John is a master stonemason. And the way that you learn how to do that is you do an apprenticeship. So that's rare, but that's the best kind of learning, is to have a really good relationship with somebody and learn from them. So the Craftsman and Apprentice, we're like, that's a good name for a business. And so we put that on the books and we tried to figure out what we could do. And we kept saying, you know what would be awesome? This and this and this. And eventually we decided that it was a viable enough idea that I would stop teaching. And at this point, I had been teaching in my neighborhood, which was magical and tough at the same time. And we had this serendipitous moment when we were looking for our space. So this is our first workshop space. It's on 22nd in Lafayette, and we live four blocks down. And we originally had a place on Welton, and it fell through, and we were kind of bummed and didn't know what to do, and I had already sold my car in order to start saving money for this new endeavor. So I was riding my bike with my littlest one in a bike trailer, so we rode up 22nd, and there was a sign in the window. And the woman who had owned the antique store passed away, and we went in, they were selling a bunch of stuff, and I met her daughters, and it had turned out that I had taught their nieces and nephews, and we had this connection, right, this like serendipitous moment where they were like, yeah, you. Like, this is good. And they put in a good word for us with our landlord, and we were able to get our first shop going. It was a lovely thing. So I'm going to give you just quick tips on serendipity. This is our new workshop space. Well, it's been about a year. And what we do there is we have social workshops for adults. And our goal is to make sure that you feel totally safe to mess up and totally happy to hang out with new people and have those serendipitous moments, right? You're like, I was in the shop the other night, and these people are like, oh, do you know so-and-so from North Carolina? Oh, yeah, let's get together for coffee. Like, it's just a connecting space because, like I said, this is the whole of how it all goes down. Community, safe places, making an environment for success. So this is our shop. When I was doing the 100 days, I came up with this philosophy of make, share, receive, and connect. So you do you, you make the things that you make, but if you do it in a vacuum, who's gonna see it? Who's gonna give you feedback to grow? And how are you gonna move forward? So you gotta share it. And then you also have to accept help. So receiving things, receiving kindness, receiving suggestions, just be open to receiving. And that way we can create connection, and connection is the thing that gives you those serendipitous moments. Does that make sense? Okay. I have two bits of advice to finish that I've learned from being around children my whole life. Just do you, and it'll happen. This kid doesn't even have pants on. He showed up to his birthday party, and who is this, Nacho Libra? Is that what it is? He doesn't have pants on, and he did his whole birthday party in his underwear. And his mom was like, yeah, let's do it. So we have a product, it's a soap carving kit, it's a little wooden knife, and when we were designing the packaging, Dan, do you guys know Dan Garza? John knows Dan Garza. He's fantastic. But we thought, here's like words to live by. Go slow, have fun, be safe, try not to freak out if it's not perfect. It's all about the process. Thank you guys so much.